Good morning, church family, and welcome back to another one of our online Sundays. You will notice from my surrounds that I'm not in my usual recording place of the auditorium, and the reason being is the painters are still busy at work and will be into next week, but they should be finished by Friday, which means that on Sunday the 16th of October at our usual time of 10 a.m. we'll be able to be not only online but back in the building as well. Then on the 30th of October we're going to be having a baptismal service. One of our young people is going to be going through the waters of baptism, and it might be something that you've been considering for yourself as well. If that's the case, then have a chat to either Matt or myself, and we'll be able to talk this through with you a little bit and see if you can take your next step in your faith journey, which will be through the waters of baptism. But for today, we read a text from 1 Peter chapter 2, and it says this: "But you're a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy." This is a wonderful description given by Peter for those who are found in Jesus. Listen to some of the things that we are told that we are. We're considered chosen, a royal priesthood, holy, God's special possession. And these are wonderful thoughts. And with these thoughts and with this understanding of these truths, there are certain implications as well. One of those is that we declare the praises of our Father in heaven. And we'll get to do that in just a few moments in song. One of the other things that we're reminded of is that we are a royal priesthood. Now, typically the priests were there to represent people to God. And so we fulfill this role in this world even today. And one of the ways that we do it is to follow in the footsteps of Jesus. We're reminded that he is interceding for us even now to our Father in heaven. And so we get to intercede for others. And so in a little while, there's going to be a slide which comes up on the screen. It's got a few prayer pointers in it. It's not an exhaustive list. You can add to the list if you like. The list will be on the screen for about 2 minutes, and there'll be some music playing in the background. But if you'd like to pray for longer, then feel free to hit the pause button and then press play again, and you can catch up with the service as we go along. But for now, we sing.
Come all you sinners, Lorena, good morning, church family. I have a question for you to start. What was the last piece of good news that you received? Perhaps it was the birth of a child or a grandchild or a great-grandchild. Perhaps it was that you heard you got the new job. Perhaps it was that your house sale went through, or you bought a new vehicle and that's good news. Or the latest Marvel movie is being released soon and that's good news. Or maybe it's the good news that there's one more week of school holidays left, and you can take that any which way you would like. We love to receive good news, don't we? Especially in today's world where we're often bombarded with more bad news than good news. Good news is a welcome relief, especially because we tend to live in a bad news kind of world. We don't have to scroll very far or pick up a newspaper much or watch the evening news to hear some bad news. Well, today I want to talk about good news, God's good news. We're in week two of our series looking at the letter to the Thessalonica church, 1 Thessalonians. And last week, James led us through chapter 1, where the author Paul commended this young church on their faithful work, their loving deeds, and their enduring hope. Faith, love, and hope. Three markers of Christianity and the good news. I think verse 5 of chapter 1 shows Paul's heart and mission. For when we, and that's Paul and his companions here, when we brought you the good news, it was not only with words, but also with power. For the Holy Spirit gave you full assurance that what we said was true. And you know of our concern for you from the way we lived when we were with you. The good news with words and with power. So what is the good news exactly? Well, rather than me trying to explain it, I thought I'd let our friends at the Bible Project do that. So have a listen to this video.
If you know any Christians, or if you happen to be one, you've probably heard the word gospel as a kind of summary of Christian belief, connected to phrases like God loves you or Jesus died for your sins. But over time, religious words like gospel can lose their power and meaning by becoming too familiar. So, let's take a moment to rediscover what this important word, gospel, meant to the people who wrote the Bible. Gospel translates the Old Testament Hebrew verb, biser, and the noun, besora. The Greek New Testament equivalent is euangelion, which is a compound word. Eu means good, and angelion means announcement. All of these words mean good news, but what kind of news? Well, in Hebrew, biser is what we might call national news, or a royal announcement. Like when King David hears a messenger, biser, that his army was victorious in battle. That means he still rules on his throne over the people of Israel. And after David dies, his throne is passed on to Solomon, his son. And when he was inaugurated as king in Jerusalem, a herald spreads the besora, that a new ruler is in charge. But after Solomon's death came a bunch of bad news kings, whose corruption led their nation into self-destruction. This is why the prophet Isaiah announced the good news that one day the God of Israel would come as the cosmic king, to confront all corrupt and violent kingdoms and restore his rule over all nations. And so, when Jesus of Nazareth hit the public stage, he continued Isaiah's gospel when he went around announcing the euangelion of God's kingdom. Jesus claimed that God was restoring his reign over his people Israel and over all nations, and he was the one bringing it all about. Now, the euangelion about a new king in charge means a new way of life. Jesus said that living in God's kingdom meant following him by putting down the sword and seeking peace through radical forgiveness and generosity, even toward your enemies. His good news required people to make a decision. This is why Jesus took his euangelion to Jerusalem to confront the corrupt and violent kingdoms of his day. But he challenged them in a surprising way with the power of God's generous love. As Jesus was being executed by his enemies, he received his crown and was mocked as a fake king. But he displayed true royal authority by forgiving his tormentors. Jesus was the one in charge that day, giving his life for the sins of others. And then, a few days later, everything changed. Jesus rose from the dead as the true king, whose love is stronger than death. He appeared to hundreds of his followers and told them to spread the Evangelion, that all authority in heaven and earth now belongs to him. And they did share this good news all over the ancient world. They did it by writing the four accounts of Jesus' life that are the gospel. That is, they tell the story of how Jesus brought God's kingdom, how he lived for others and died for their sins, and then was raised from the dead. Jesus' followers also shared the good news by simply talking about it. This is why Peter and Paul, or Priscilla and Aquila, traveled all around sharing the royal announcement. While it might look like the rulers of our world are in charge and can do whatever they want, the good news is that the crucified and risen Jesus is the true Lord of the world, the real King of all creation. And in Jesus' kingdom, things are different. It's where the real leaders are the servants, because the last are first and the first go to the back of the line. It's where the hungry are fed and the homeless are welcome, because love is the most powerful reality of God's kingdom. And this good news is not easy to believe. It actually sounds kind of crazy when you first hear it, but something happens when people tell the story of Jesus and start living like he really is the king of the world. That's when this gospel becomes the best news that you've ever heard.
Oh, I love this stuff. I hope you do as well. Paul continues this theme of good news in chapter 2 of his letter, and he mentions it four times in these 12 verses that we're going to go through this morning. So we're going to read and we're going to stop each time that we hear good news, and we'll look at what Paul is saying. So let's start with verses 1 to 3. You yourselves know, dear brothers and sisters, that our visit to you was not a failure. You know how badly we had been treated at Philippi just before we came to you, and how much we suffered there. Yet our God gave us the courage to declare his good news to you boldly in spite of great opposition. So you can see we were not preaching with any deceit or impure motives or trickery. Here's point one. The good news often comes with opposition. Paul begins this chapter by reminding the church that, you know, he and his companions, they faced opposition and they had persecution thrown their way. Yet God gave them the courage to declare the good news with no deceit or impure motives. For Paul, the opposition that they faced, it didn't mean to stop. Quite the opposite. In anything, it actually meant speed up. Now, if we read through Paul's other letters in the New Testament, you could say that for him, opposition or suffering for the good news meant that he was on the right track. So why stop? Because progress was being made. I wonder if you've heard the phrase, character is formed in the crucible of suffering. It's terrible to think about that phrase, isn't it? But I wonder, it's very, very true. I've seen in my own life and lots of other people's lives too. You can look at Christians throughout the centuries after Jesus and see that they often paid the price for declaring and living out the good news. And what's more, they willingly paid the price. They had courage and endurance and a conviction that the good news was worth the opposition that they faced, and it was worth giving their lives for, which often happened. Just a few weeks back, my kids and I were watching a short movie based on the life of Corrie ten Boom. Now, Corrie and her family were a family that helped the Jews escape the Nazi Holocaust during World War II. And the family saved close to 800 people, they estimate. So they lived and they shared the good news with the people around them, despite knowing the opposition that they faced from the Nazis. And there was, you know, it was very severe. Corrie and her sister Betsy were taken to a concentration camp where they continued to share the good news in word and in deed with the people around them. And the opposition they faced, it actually was deadly, and it resulted in Betsy's death. Now, their lives had been so radically changed by the good news that they were willing to live it out, and they were willing to pay the price. They wanted other people to experience the same freedom that they experienced, which came from God. And this is what Paul is getting at here. He declared and lived out the good news despite any opposition that came his way. And what was the result of that? Well, the church grew. The church blossomed. And did you know that right now, the persecuted church around the world is flourishing? I think about the church in Iran. It is growing incredibly fast. Experts say that it's growing because of three things. First is the courageous witness of evangelists. They are doing it with courage. And it's growing through visions and dreams that God is using to speak to people over there. But they say it's mostly growing through opposition. And that's persistent persecution that they're facing. People are declaring the good news. They're starting churches. They're starting home churches. They're living out what they believe. And they're giving their lives for the sake of others around them, which is incredible. It makes me think, do we live with the same conviction about the good news and declare and live it out in our lives, despite any opposition we might face? Lord, help us to be bold like Paul, like Currie and her family, like the persecuted church around the world, and declaring and living out your good news. Let's continue in verses 4-6. For we speak as messengers approved by God to be entrusted with the good news. Our purpose is to please God, not people. He alone examines the motives of our hearts. Never once did we try to win you with flattery, as you well know. And God is our witness that we were not pretending to be your friends just to get your money. As for human praise, we have never sought it from you or anyone else. Here's point number two. The good news comes with trust and authority. I often marvel that God trusts people. He trusts you and I with sharing and living the good news out. He has entrusted you and me to share Jesus with those around us. And just think about that for a moment. What an honor that we have been given. Well, here Paul is telling the church that he and his companions were entrusted by God and sent with authority to declare the good news in word and in deed. Now, authority is not a popular thing to talk about nowadays. People can seem wary or against authority, and sometimes with good right. But as God's people, we need to know and live and the authority that we have. It's to preach the good news of the kingdom. It's to heal the sick. It's to cast out demons. It's to release the captives. It's to bring joy to the brokenhearted. It's to bring transformation through the good news. And it's all because of Jesus. Before he ascended to his Father in heaven, Jesus told his disciples then and now that all authority, not some, but all authority had been given to him in heaven and on earth. And in authority, his disciples then and now were to go into all the world and to disciple the nations and to baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And just quickly, if you're thinking about being baptized, we'd love to baptize you on the 30th of this month. So talk to us about that. Coming back to the text, Jesus promises here that he will be with his followers always. So, just as Paul's authority to share and live out the good news comes from God, so too does your authority and my authority, our authority to live it out. Which means that we shouldn't shrink back from opportunities that God places in front of us in our path. If we feel a prompt to share the good news with a friend, with a neighbor, with a colleague, let's trust him to lead us in there and ask for wisdom in it. If as a church we sense the need to connect with a certain group in our community or a certain place beyond our community, let's trust him in that. Because he has trusted us, given us the authority, and promises to be with us. It's like he's given us the keys to the kingdom and he said, it's yours, it's yours. I trust you with it and I trust you to tell others about it. See, authority comes with responsibility. As a parent with young kids and one in the teenage years now, my wife and I often talk about, you know, when it's the right time to give authority and responsibility to them. Now, the big one for us this year has been trusting our oldest son with a cell phone. Prior to coming up to Auckland last year, we didn't have a phone to give to our oldest son. We didn't give him one. He didn't need one. And we were pretty happy about that, to be honest. But once we were here, we knew that he needed one because he gets the bus to and from school every day for one thing, and he needs the phone to contact us if needed. And there was a time when he ended up in Silverdale and we had to go get him, which was good he had a phone to let us know. But it became clear that we needed to trust him with a phone. So we trusted him and we gave him authority to have a phone. But there was responsibility that came with this trust and authority. Things like keep it in your bag at school, use it when needed only, the family rule of not having a phone in your bedroom, the limit on data, you know, you get the idea, these things. With trust and authority came responsibility. And it's the same with us and the trust and authority that we've been given to share and live out the good news. See, God has given us that authority and that trust, and it's something that we shouldn't take lightly and we shouldn't take it for granted either. As Paul says to the church, let our words and our deeds be done for an audience of one. Let us not be people pleasers. Let us be God pleasers with our lives. Because God knows our hearts. He knows what's going on inside. Are our hearts and our lives pleasing to God as we share and live out the good news that he has entrusted us with and given us authority in? Lord, help us to live first and foremost for you, knowing that we are trusted and given authority to declare the good news. Let's carry on in verses 7 to 8. Paul continues, as apostles of Christ, we certainly had a right to make some demands of you, but instead we were like children among you, or we were like a mother feeding and caring for her own children. We love you so much that we shared with you not only God's good news, but our own lives too. Point number three is the good news is meant to be lived out in community or in relationship with others. You might have noticed that the tone Paul uses changes quite dramatically here, and he becomes much more personal with family language. He knows the people that he is talking to, and he cares for them just like a mother with her children. There isn't really a more nurturing and warm human relationship than that, is there? Gentle, patient, loving, intentional. It's quite something here to just step back and remember that Paul only knew the people here for less than a month. At the start of this letter, he tells them that they bring him great joy and he loves them dearly. And that's genuine because out of all of the letters to the churches that he wrote to in the New Testament, this seems to be one of the only churches that he didn't have something to complain about, or he didn't have something that was grieving his heart that they were doing or that he was hearing or that that there was experience going on there. This was a pastor's dream church, really. Faithful, vibrant, committed family. Living out the good news and sharing their lives together. The good news is not meant to be lived and kept in isolation. It's not the Jesus and I gospel that is often preached and talked, and it's much, much bigger than that. The good news is meant to be lived out in community and relationship with others. If you follow the life of Jesus and the gospels, You see that he's often surrounded by people. He's alone when he has time with his father alone, but he's surrounded by people when he shares the good news. His inner circle is a group of 12 disciples who he shares his life with, and his most intimate moments are shared with three of them, with Peter, James, and John. Community is a huge part of the gospel message. We celebrate with each other. We commiserate with one another. We hold each other up. We hold each other to account as well. We believe the best in each other, and we want the best for each other. We care about the people that we do life together, and that's within and outside the church or the faith community as well. So for you, this might mean being part of an intentional small group where you share life together, you disciple one another, and you reach out to those around you. Or maybe if you're not, maybe it's time to join one or start a new one. Or perhaps it means going for a coffee with someone from church, talking about what's happening in each other's lives, sharing what God is saying or doing, what you think, and then inviting someone else to come and be part of that as well. That's community right there. Maybe it's inviting the people next door to you around for a meal. Maybe it's inviting your child's friend's parents from school around for afternoon tea, or whatever it is, whoever it is that God is placing in front of you. The good news is meant to be lived in community. We go and we grow together. There's an African proverb that I love that says this: if you want to go fast, go alone. If you want to go far, go together. So true. Go with others. So, are we sharing the good news and living it out in community and in relationship with others? Lord, help us to live more communally minded, to see the needs of others around us and intentionally reach out to those who don't know you and don't know the good news. Let's continue, finishing with verses 9 to 12. Paul says, "Don't you remember, dear brothers and sisters, how hard we worked among you? Night and day we toiled to earn a living so that we would not be a burden to any of you as we preached God's good news to you. You yourselves are our witnesses, and so is God, that we were devout and honest and faultless toward all of you believers. And you know that we treated each of you as a father treats his own children. We pleaded with you, encouraged you, and urged you to live your lives in a way that God would consider worthy. For he called you to share in his kingdom and glory." My final point about the good news: it's not meant to come as a burden to others, and we're in it for the long haul. It's an endurance. It's not a sprint. It's an endurance race. See, Paul and his companions worked hard to earn a living so that they could preach the good news and not be a burden to the church. They weren't preaching the good news to try and tie people down or get money out of them, as what was happening in other churches around at the same time. But the good news is freeing, and it's meant to be shared freely as well. Now, there's often a burden or a calling, if you like, on our lives to share the good news in our lives on a daily basis with the people we come into contact. But when people hear the good news and see it in other people's lives, it shouldn't come with any strings attached. Paul didn't want himself or the good news to become a burden to the people, which is why he says, "Day and night we worked hard to earn a living." He and his companions were devout and honest and faultless. They were invested in the church at Thessalonica and in it for the long haul. We are invested in our community here at Long Bay, and we're in it for the long haul, aren't we? We want to see people and places transformed through our different ministries and groups and outreach that we have here as we share and live out the good news. Through our early childhood center, our housing trust, our youth work at the college, our mainly music team, our Wider Horizon lunch group, our Brazilian, Korean, and Chinese fellowships, our Alpha discipleship groups, our small groups, and everything else that we are doing and not doing yet, we are sharing and being the good news in our community without being a burden and in it for the long haul. That's our mission. That was Paul's mission. And that mission came from Jesus himself. He proclaimed that God's kingdom has come, and he gave his followers the authority and the decree to share and live out the good news. He said, heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse those who have leprosy, drive out demons, freely you have received, freely give. Like Paul, we are to declare and live the good news with word and with power, the power of the Holy Spirit within. It's not a burden, it's freeing, and it's a gift that we are meant to give out to others, meant to be shared with those around us. So are we sharing and living out the good news in a freeing way, showing that we are in it for the long haul? Lord, help us live in such a way that people look at our lives and see the freedom and the power that the good news brings. As Paul finishes in verse 12, let these words bring us to a close. We plead, encourage, and urge you to live your lives in a way that God would consider worthy. For he called you to share in his kingdom and glory. This is what the good news is meant to lead to. Our personal lives and our faith communities reflecting God's kingdom and bringing glory to him. So, when it comes to the good news, may we, in our lives and in this church, may we share and live out the good news in our own lives and in the life of the church, despite any opposition we might face, knowing that we are entrusted and have been given authority by God himself, seeking to be in community and relationship with others within and outside the church, not being a burden, but in it for the long haul. We ask that this will reflect God's kingdom and bring all honor and glory to him. For it's in Jesus' name and for his purposes that we pray. Amen. May it be so. May it be so.